Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this service for Stamford Methodist Church and Stamford Methodist Circuit, which is coming to you from our kitchen. Due to restrictions with coronavirus crisis, it's having to. So I want also to say a very, very big thank you to my wife, Lynne, who's going to be helping with some of the technicalities and also doing our reading from the Gospel. This service was recorded yesterday because I'm technically challenged and this whole thing is an adventure for me. So be patient, please. Just enjoy the service straight through. If you have an order of service afterwards, you could follow the links on YouTube to the hymns and the song. So we're worshipping God in this service during this time of crisis. Many of us are self-isolating. All of us should be social distancing. And some of us will be afraid, and some feeling crushed by fear of loneliness. But we're all called to support each other. And during this service, we're holding each other in the love of Christ, praying for one another as he holds us. Jesus is with us. He says to us, as he said to his disciples in the Gospels, "Do not be afraid, little flock." He is with us. So let's pray to the Holy Spirit who enables us to worship God. Heavenly King, our Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, present in all places and filling all things, treasury of good gifts and giver of life, come and abide in us. Cleanse us from every stain of sin and save our souls, O gracious one. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So let's worship God as we sing together, as we can, the hymn from Singing the Faith, number 351, In Christ Alone, Who Took on Flesh. And as we sing this, you're going to be looking at one of my favourite, a copy of one of my favourite icons, which is of Jesus with one of his saints, and Jesus has his arm round his shoulder, as he has for all of us.
In Christ alone, who took His body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious
again. It's amazing. This is all being broadcast to you from Lynne's mobile phone. So, in the power of the Spirit and in the name of Jesus Christ, let us pray. O God, you are love. You call us to live in that love, to be changed by it, and to love others as you love us. In Scripture, you say to us, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength." You say, "Love your neighbour as you love yourself." You say, "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another." You say, "Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven." And you say, "In everything do to others as you would have them do to you, for this is the law and the prophets." So have mercy on us, Lord. You challenge us to love, because that is how and who you are. In the story of Adam and Eve, you come, walking in the cool of the garden, calling out to us, "Where are you? Have you done the thing that I forbade you?" But like Adam and Eve, we often hide from you behind the bush because we know we've not loved as you love us. Instead of coming out, standing before you and letting you look into our face, instead of saying to you, "Yes, I have. Please help me." Instead, we often blame others or despair about ourselves and still refuse to face you, thinking we're in control. In Christ, you became one of us, came into our dark shadow place with us, called us out of darkness into your marvellous light, and gave your life, dying for our forgiveness. Lord Jesus, risen from the dead, you come now to invite each of us to take your hand and follow, trusting in your victory over sin, over death, and over evil, to be transformed by the power of your Holy Spirit in us, so that we love as you love. And let's keep a moment of silence before God. Christ himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. Amen. Hallelujah. And so, united with Christ, his arm round our shoulder, let's join with him and with all God's people in heaven and on earth, saying together the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We're going to use now Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy. If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can with reverence serve you. I wait for the Lord. My whole being waits, and in his word I put my hope. I wait for the Lord more than watchmen wait for the morning, more than watchmen wait for the morning. Israel, put your hope in the Lord. For with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Lynn is going to read for us now our reading from John's Gospel.
Now, a man named Lazarus was ill. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. The Mary whose brother Lazarus now lay ill was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is ill." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This illness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed where he was 2 more days. And then he said to his disciples, "Let us go back to Judea." "But Rabbi," they said, "short while ago the Jews there tried to stone you, and yet you're going back." Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Anyone who walks in the daytime will not stumble, for they see by this world's light. It is when a person walks at night that they stumble, for they have no light." After he'd said this, he went on to tell them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him up." His disciples replied, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better." Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. And for your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Then Thomas, also known as Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, "Let us also go that we may die with him." On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied. "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God who is to come into the world." After she'd said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here," she said, "and is asking for you." And when Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house, comforting her, noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. And then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there's a bad odour. He's been in there 4 days." And Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." When he'd said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. And Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did believed in him.
It's a little bit cramped in here. So let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the thoughts of all our minds be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. In John's Gospel, this is the longest of any of the miracle stories apart from the resurrection of Jesus himself. And like the others, it's told with great feeling. I want to share with you my understanding of this story. The family of Lazarus is unusual in the Gospels. It's Lazarus and his two sisters, Martha and Mary, and it's clear that Jesus feels very, very much at home with them, and Lazarus is called his friend. I think Jesus has known them for a long time, maybe from childhood. They live at Bethany, just 2 miles from Jerusalem. Now, all Jews were obliged to go to Jerusalem for the 3 annual festivals of Passover, Pentecost and Tabernacles, and Jesus' own family certainly sometimes went from Nazareth to Jerusalem for this, as he grew up. I think they may have stayed with this family on those occasions, maybe even being related. Certainly, there's a warm, close and easy familiarity between them and Jesus. Now, this household consists of 2 sisters and a brother. Martha, seeming the oldest sister, is the head of the family, not Lazarus. And Lazarus never speaks, although both his sisters do, and both of them appear to have very strong characters, Martha being outspoken, addressing Jesus directly and sometimes abruptly, Mary less vocal, but with powerful gestures on one occasion, sitting at Jesus' feet with his disciples, while Martha's going frantic trying to feed them all. And after this event of the raising of Lazarus, a few days after, at a meal with lots of guests in a neighbour's house, Mary smashes a very expensive alabaster jar and pours its entire very, very costly contents of pure oil of spikenard over Jesus' feet, much to the shock and confusion of many and the fury of Judas. It seems also that they're quite a poor family. There are no servants or anyone else to help Martha when she's going frantic trying to offer the customary hospitality and desperately needs Mary's help. But it's Jesus she appeals to ask her sister to help, not Lazarus. Strange. And then there's the parable Jesus tells in Luke's Gospel about the rich man and a poor beggar called Lazarus. It's the only parable in all the Gospels where Jesus tells one with any character being given a name, Lazarus. And in it, Lazarus is covered with sores, begging at the rich man's gate, longing to satisfy his hunger with scraps that might fall from the rich man's table. Then both Lazarus and the rich man die. And from his place of torment, the rich man pleads with Father Abraham to send Lazarus from his place of paradise back to his five brothers to warn them to repent, so they don't end up where he is. But Abraham says to the rich man, if they don't listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced even if someone rises from the dead. Lazarus rising from the dead. Now I know that many scholars don't think there's any connection between Lazarus, the brother of Martha and Mary, and Lazarus of the parable. But I really think there is. And if Lazarus was a beggar because of some disability, that makes complete sense of all the other unusual things about this household. Why no one is married? Martha and Mary staying with Lazarus to support and care for him. Martha being the eldest sister, being head of the household rather than Lazarus. Lazarus never actually speaking. And Martha and Mary having such forthright, strong characters, just like the parents or family carers of people with disabilities today, who are often prepared to be considered nuisances because they always have to fight on behalf of the one they love so fiercely, and their household life can be quite eccentric because it has to revolve around the needs of the disabled member. But what such households often also embody in oodles is the most extraordinary love, where family members value their togetherness and each person matters absolutely, rather than the worldly values of wealth or power or status or reputation. That all had to go out of the window ages ago. So, Jesus at last comes to Bethany. Martha greets him, immediately expressing her anger, frustration, and grief. Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. And Jesus responds, your brother will rise again. Martha says, I know he'll rise again in the resurrection on the last day. And Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Then Mary comes, and immediately she greets him with exactly the same words as her sister. But when they go to the cave where Lazarus is buried, the emotion pours out. Lazarus had been the centre of the sisters' life, the reason they had never married and why their family life was so eccentric and so resplendent with close, down-to-earth, fierce love that would have overcome any obstacle to support and to celebrate each other. But now he's dead. And despite all their efforts, Jesus hadn't come. And they're deeply disappointed and angry with him and full of sadness and grief. And as they weep and all the other people with them, Jesus weeps too, deeply, tears streaming. And as he stands before the tomb, He says, "Take the stone away." And he cries out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." We're going to sing the hymn now, "And Can It Be," which is in Singing the Faith, number 345. This great hymn of the triumph of Jesus and all that he's done for us and how that can work in our lives.
Thank you.
So let us pray. There may, by the way, be things that you would like to comment on or to ask for prayer for, thoughts and reflections that you might like to share. And although this service is pre-recorded, you can still respond on Facebook, on the circuit Facebook page. And those are things that can be listened to and shared as appropriate. So please do. So let us pray. O Lord God, in the power of your Holy Spirit, who enables us to pray, who brings us into your life, we offer you thanks and praise. Lord Jesus, you are the resurrection and the life. Through you and for you all things were made. At the heart of this entire creation and beyond it, you are the presence of love. And in you, all things find their fulfillment. And you, Lord, are the resurrection and the life for us. We thank you for the life that we have. We thank you for all our relationships and the chance to love and be loved. Whatever our abilities or gifts, whatever our disabilities and the things that we struggle with, you want us to become your friends, to know and to trust you and be a blessing for others. And this is the reason why we live. And a prayer now for those who are in mourning. Christ Jesus, you understand the pain of loss that seems to take the air from my lungs. You are the resurrection and the life. All our hope is in you. Lord Jesus, may I find a way through the darkness to the light of your love. You are the resurrection and the life. All our hope is in you. Christ Jesus, you wept at the death of your friend, Lazarus. Now your compassion wipes the tears from our eyes. May we find comfort in reaching out to others who feel lost and alone. You are the resurrection and the life. All our hope is in you. Amen. In our prayers now, you might like to join in the response when I say the words, Lord, in your mercy, we say together, hear our prayer. So, Lord, at this time of world crisis, we thank you for the ways that it makes us realise we belong together and need to think about others' needs as well as our own. May it teach us and change us to be a better world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the world and national leaders, for the United Nations and the World Health Organization. We pray for our government. We pray for our MP, for our county councillors and local councillors. And we pray for local council staff trying to adapt, trying to support the community. Give them the strength and the wisdom that they need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who are afraid at this time. Thank you that you, risen from the dead, our Lord of heaven and earth, and that eventually all creation will reflect your love. fill us all with this joyful vision and hope. And when we seem about to be overwhelmed with fear, help us to recognise your signs all around us, a bird song in the quiet stillness, the spring life rising all around us, your arm around our shoulder. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For we ask all our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our final hymn is a great hymn to the Holy Spirit. Father of everlasting grace, in singing the faith number 378, to the tune called Stamford, it could become our circuit hymn, our own song and motto. So I'm going to use this icon again of Jesus with his arm round the shoulder of his friend, the saint. Christ, who calls us out of darkness into his marvellous light, shine on you and shine on us all with the joy, the sheer joy of his salvation and his loving presence. And shall we say together the grace, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. God bless you. Amen.